Hello, everybody. Here's Tony Gosling. He's going to talk to us today about the revolutionary potential of journalism. His background, he started out in community radio, spent some time at the BBC. He was very involved in the launch of The Land Is Ours and did that for some time. And after a period doing independent work, he's now actually with Russia Today. But he's here to talk about journalism.
Okay, thank you. Hello, everyone. I thought I'd start by one of the basic simple tips of journalism. And I think it's probably better to contextualize this whole thing about journalism being revolutionary. This is a quote from George Orwell. George Orwell saying, you know, telling the truth is a revolutionary act. And I think that really is where we are in Britain today. It's a very sad thing to say, but journalism is in a diabolical state. Just as one example of how you can actually measure how bad things are is looking back into the 1970s and 80s and even the 90s. We had a whole plethora of investigative teams working in television in Britain. We had World in Action. We've had also an amazing program called The Cook Report, which where any individual could go to these programs and say, well, I've got a story here, and they would have the resources to investigate and write it up and broadcast it to the world. Nowadays, we've really only got two programs that do that, but that's Dispatches on Channel 4 and Panorama on the BBC. And those versions, the modern versions of those programs, are really neutered. Just as an example, we had a big news story again yesterday about the state of prisons in Britain, the fact that they're underfunded, etc. This has been a running sore in the country in the privatisation of prisons over the last two or three years under the coalition government. And what do Panorama do? They do an hour-long documentary on US prisons. So they're very... it's almost like now we're getting government-approved broadcasting from the BBC and from other broadcasters too. And there's no spread of proper investigative journalism at the cutting edge in broadcasting. There's quite a lot going on in the print and in newspapers and individual writers, individual journalists getting stuff published online, but this isn't finding its way into our living rooms and into the mass media anymore. So my little hint for anyone that's interested, and I think anyone that takes seriously the journalism's role in politics, is always carry a notebook. Always carry a notebook. You never know when somebody's number's going to come in handy in a later time. Whether something that somebody said, a quote that they've said, is going to be useful on your blog, if you do blogging, or anywhere. But the fact of the matter is that Big Brother is out there, and Big Brother is trying to make sure that you forget everything that's important and your life is filled up with mush and game shows and anything that doesn't matter. There's a big effort out there in the mass media to fill our lives. Just one example, we've had all this horrific stuff going on in Gaza over the last few weeks. And what's happened on Radio 5 Live? This is what we pay for, state broadcasting, supposed to do the job and tell us what's going on. We've had the World Cup, wall-to-wall World Cup. We've had also the PGA Golf Championship. And now we've got the Commonwealth Games for the last couple of weeks. Wall-to-wall sport, and there's no proper actual analysis of what's going on. This is actually a really pernicious arm of the genocide that's going on in Gaza now, is the fact that the people who are supposed to be telling us what's going on are actually off on holiday or they're off on a golf course and they're doing something completely different to what they're supposed to be doing. And you know, there's all sorts of other things to do with the timing of Gaza. For example, we're now in parliamentary recess. There's no proper discussion about it in Parliament. There's all sorts of reasons why the timing of these things happen as they do, and a lot of it is to do with the media. So one of the things I've always been interested in is Freemasonry. Now, I don't know if people around here know much about it, but this subject runs through a lot of the work I've done over the years, a lot of stories. I've found often Masonic connections at the bottom of it. We were just hearing about the mysteries of the planning system. Why do people act like they do within the planning system? Well, I can tell you there's actually a very good documentary online about Masonic influence on planning permission down in Dorset. It was made by BBC South TV when I was actually, funnily enough, just after I'd left there working on radio, the TV people did a regional documentary exposing how developers were actually on the planning committees, in the planning committees, people are in the same Masonic lodge as another one, were mysteriously awarding planning permission against the advice of planning officers, etc. Very, very clear links. I think the company's called CJ Fry. The company is a developer that's building Prince Charles's Poundbury site. The guy's a Freemason, and he was in same lodge as the chair of the planning committee in Dorset County Council. Freemasonry it should be there in all of our business probity. If anyone's been involved in business, you'll know that every business has got some kind of probity policy once it reaches a certain size. But where do you ever see people declaring their Masonic affiliations in there? They don't. It's a cult. It's a religious cult. And it runs through a lot of the work I do. I keep coming across time and time again, and particular individuals are Freemasonry's connections to wrongdoing. Then, of course, we've had, I mean, it was nice, thanks very much for the introduction. One of the things we've had since the Land is Ours, and probably even during the Land is Ours' existence, we were doing land rights occupations in the 1990s, was police infiltration of environmental movement. Now, this is the Stasi, folks. This is the Stasi. This is Eastern Europe. This is Soviet-style totalitarian government. When the government sends in police or agents into organisations, not just to infiltrate them, but to get deeply, deeply embedded. And in fact, we've had kids having been had with environmentalists. This is just appalling, isn't it? I mean, this is thankfully one brave guy has actually got no friends, but he's exposed it. You know, and thank God someone actually did do that. It shows how important it is to have a reasonably accessible media. So the question is, almost certainly more will come out about infiltration of the environmental movement. We've only maybe even seen a bit of the tip of the iceberg, because it's all being sat on, just like the Westminster paedophile questions that are coming up at the moment. We had two inquiries, haven't we, set up by Theresa May. Both of those inquiries set up by, run by people who are totally unapproachable by victims. Now, why would that be? Why would that be? Lady Butler Schloss, her husband, was one of the people that stopped the investigation of child abuse in the 1980s, and yet she's put in charge of the next investigation. The other guy, I can't remember the guy's name, from the NSPCC, he was supposed to do the quick reporting inquiry, and probably still will. He was the permanent secretary to Michael Portillo. There were big conservative secretary of state, big allegations against Portillo. So what's happening is there's cover-ups going on, carrying on. And it seems that there's a culture of impunity now in this country. Anyway, I thought best way to start would be to talk about two or three stories that I've investigated over the last couple of years that have got I've found fascinating in one way or another, that kind of make you question the official version of history. We'll start in September 1944, right, during the Second World War, the Battle of Arnhem. This was a parachute invasion of Holland. It was the liberation of Holland. But all sorts of very weird things happened during that attack. It was right at the very end of the Second World War, towards the end anyway. And there's a lot of evidence that the British and the Americans were already doing deals with the Nazis, because the Nazis knew they were going to lose, and they were thinking, well, how are we going to do some deals? And also, how are we going to delay the end of the war so that we can get all of our loot that we've looted from all over Europe out of Berlin and secrete it around the world? And Operation Market Garden is really, I found fascinating, because the Dutch liaison officer that was in Britain, that was doing the liaison between the Dutch resistance on the ground and the British forces as they were about to parachute into Arnhem, Nijmegen. Has anyone seen the film A Bridge Too Far? Yeah, because that film really is the film of the battle. And it was quite clear, if you look at it, that this guy who was doing the liaison, Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands, was actually a former SS officer before the war. And there he is in Whitehall with all our army, etc., peering over the top of the plans of Monty, and I think it was General Horrocks, one of the generals who was involved in the invasion. There's actually photographs of him looking over their shoulder, looking at the maps of the plan of the invasion. So anyway, the whole thing was a disaster. It ended up being a disaster. But later it was found out that the secret agent that was sent in by Bernhard to contact all the resistance in Holland, right across Holland, this guy who was he was called Christian Lindemans, who was nicknamed King Kong, turned out he was a German agent. Instead of when they got him into Holland, instead of going to make contact with all of the resistance movements, he went straight to the Nazis with all the information about the plans for the invasion of Holland. So you can see there's some pretty high level dodgy stuff going on there. This then leads on in another thing I've looked at over the years, something called the Bilderberg conferences, because Prince Bernhard, the guy who I was just talking about, was this Dutch liaison officer with the British in the invasion of Holland that was such a disaster. He ended up 10 years later in the same spot, Oosterbeek in Holland, chairing the first Bilderberg conference. Now, hands up anyone has heard of the Bilderbergs? Yes, at least half of you anyway. Because it's been a bit of a mission of mine over the last 15 years or so to just try and raise awareness of this organisation. They bring together the banking elite, the military industrial complex, that's the big arms firms, as well as oil companies and media. It's like Rupert Murdoch's general manager will go along to these meetings, this kind of thing, and the BBC, by the way. What they're doing is they're inviting in the politicians, and they're basically giving the politicians, and in fact you can even see the photographs of this going on at the last Bilderberg conference that just happened in Copenhagen a couple of months ago. There's George Osborne sitting down there getting his orders from the financial elite. He sits there for about, I think, three quarters of an hour getting a lecture from one of these big financiers being told what to do. And then, of course, Ed Balls is also going along to these Bilderberg conferences. They happen every year. Ed Balls, George Osborne. Okay, so are we just getting Bilderberg finance policy in Britain rather than any kind of difference between Labour and Conservative? I mean, just unbelievable, really, that they should be swearing secrecy, our politicians, as they go into these conferences, and then coming out and we say, well, what happened in there? Well, I can't tell you. In the US, that's actually a criminal offence for a politician to go into a meeting like that, an elected politician. In Britain, you're just breaching the ministerial code if you do it, right? But who's in charge of policing the ministerial code? David Cameron. And he went to the meeting too. And he also swore secrecy. So you've got a really dangerous, it's effectively a cult. When you step inside those walls, you're not allowed to talk about who you spoke to. You can talk about the policy they want you to talk about, of course, but you're not allowed to say where you heard it or anything like that. So very interesting, these Bilderberg conferences. And maybe if we had Roger Cook and the Cook Report around still, they would do a little raid on the Bilderberg conference. Maybe Roger Cook would dress up as a barman or something and then they could film inside. But anyway, interesting, I find that just at the time when where our democracy is being subverted in this way, so many of our great old investigative programs have been neutered. So anyway, that was September 1944. I also want to talk about April 1963. Can I just ask anybody, does anyone know anything that happened in April 1963, apart from I was 1 year old? No, that was the end of 62. Any other guesses? April 1963, put yourself, if you're old enough. Not bad, that's November 1963. April 1963? No, we just had that, no. It was the beaching report, right? The beaching report. Richard Cotterill, he used to edit the magazine for the British Aircraft Corporation when they made things like airliners, and of course they made nasty jets too, but you know there was a thing called the British Aircraft Corporation that made aeroplanes years ago. Richard Cotterill has brought out a book last year just at about the same time as the beaching anniversary in April called Bomber Beaching. Bomber Beaching was an interesting character because even when he arrived on the scene, the public scene, to dismantle our railway systems. And every time I go along a road and I see bridge abutments with no bridge over the top, I think of beaching and I curse him. Because, of course, he is really the most important reason why we've got this horrendous pollution of cars going on in Britain. And by the way, the reason that they kept, I mean, most environmentalists hate coal, but the reason that they kept steam engines going so long in Britain, much longer than many other parts of Europe, was because we had this plentiful supply of coal. And they were saying, well, look, why should we go over to diesel, et cetera? Why don't we just keep carrying using coal because we've got loads of coal? But anyway, Beeching's mysterious past. What was he doing before he destroyed the railways? Well, he did pretty much destroy them, because what he did was he took all of the, looked at all the profits of all of the different lines, and he made sure that only the high profit margin lines were allowed to survive. Anything that was a low profit margin, the figures were all fixed. They found that out in the Isle of Wight, if people don't know. In the Isle of Wight, all the figures were exposed to the public, because everywhere else in the country they were secret. On the Isle of Wight, they found they'd actually made up level crossings, made up signal boxes, they'd made up various things to do with the railways to try and make it look as if it was costing much more than it really was. The whole thing was a fix. Beeching had come from ICI. Now, what ICI had just been doing in the 1940s and 50s, they'd been making explosives. And he was actually a metallurgist. So the idea of putting him in charge of a massive public corporation to go through the books and find out what was, find out what was paying and what wasn't paying, ridiculous. A metallurgist can't do that. He's good at metal. And he, for example, during the war, he designed something called the Piat, which was fired by soldiers at German tanks. And it wasn't very good. I mean, I know my uncle said he tried using this thing and it did just bounced off the tank. That was Beeching. But after the war, he was, there's a sort of gap, isn't there? You got him in the 60s, and in the 40s he was making explosives and silly little things that didn't work very well. But in the 1950s, he was involved in something called tube alloys, as Richard Cottrell exposes in his book. Tube alloys was the British nuclear bomb project. It was based at a place called Fort Halstead in the North Downs in Kent, under the hills of the North Downs. And Beeching had been working on that for about 10 years. So he came straight out of developing the British atomic bomb. He's ostensibly chairman of ICI, but his big job was atomic weapons, straight into destroying the railways. And so I'd recommend anyone that's interested in this history, because it really is important when you're looking, every time you're in a traffic jam or you're in a place which is covered with cars and cursing them, Beeching is your man. He's the guy to nail. And so Richard's book is called Bomber Beeching, His War on the Railways. And it's actually very entertaining. Richard's a fantastic writer. I think it's only maybe available as a Kindle book at the moment, but it is an absolutely brilliant read. I think ultimately we can't carry on like this. We are going to have to go back to the pre-Beeching days and start to open up some of these old railways again. In fact, you're almost seeing it, aren't you, with some of these heritage railways chugging backwards and forwards. They're almost waiting for the day when we start seeing a kind of sane transport world again, and they can then chuff back onto a bigger line or whatever. But anyway, nice to see that. And one thing positive to say about that whole thing was that it has preserved some of the old railways. But Beeching, I think, a fascinating character. And of course, he was only employed to do that job, to destroy the railways, to make the way for the car, because everybody knew after the atom bomb project he could keep his mouth shut and he wasn't going to tell everyone what was going on. I think the implications for today are massive of what Beeching did, and for the environment more generally, and just not all that well known. Let's go forward. Well, with some of these things I've been looking at over the last couple of years. June 1967. Anyone want to guess what was going on? June 1967, a big, momentous... Sorry? Oh, right, okay. It was momentous, but sorry. But anything sort of bigger? Six-Day War. Right, because we're obviously everyone's thinking about Gaza at the moment. Anyone with a soul is thinking about Gaza, and that was a very important war. I was actually had the privilege of interviewing a former shadow foreign secretary Gerald Kaufman last week about Gaza, and his line on it. I mean, he was under the I think it was the, Kinnock government and various other Kinnock Labour Party and various other. Absolutely amazing guy, Jewish, but extremely against what's going on. And he actually said on the radio when I interviewed him, he said, my grandmother didn't die in her bed at the hands of a Nazi soldier's bullet to provide cover for what's going on now in Palestine. Very, very, I mean, really quite an amazing guy to talk to. But he was absolutely adamant, Gerald, that the big problem in Israel and Palestine started in the Six-Day War, because in the Six-Day War, the Israelis basically annexed or took over the whole of what had been self-governed Palestinian territories. But another thing that happened, which was in a way more fascinating for me, was there was the Americans have something called the Sixth Fleet that sits in the Eastern Mediterranean. I mean, it's, you know, I don't know quite what it's up to today. But in 1967, its main job was just listening. What is going on? Listening to the Israeli communications, listening to the Egyptian communications. And the main ship that was doing that was something called the USS Liberty. USS Liberty was hearing all sorts of interesting stuff going on with the Israelis. Anyway, what happened was, out of the blue, a squadron of fighter jets and a load of motor torpedo boats came out from the coast and attacked the Liberty. It was in international waters. And then disappeared again. They really did their best to sink it. This is a US boat in international waters. The US is not in this war. And then they disappeared off again. They had all the markings to say what nation it was. The aircraft had the markings painted out, and the ships had had the markings painted out, so it wasn't recognisable immediately whose they were. Anyway, the Sixth Fleet is quite a sort of big thing, and they have radar, and they were following the planes to see where they went on the radar, and also taking photographs and this sort of thing. And it took them about 15 minutes, the admiral of the Sixth Fleet, to work out that these were Israeli jets and Israeli motor torpedo boats. And who was it that was the admiral in charge of the Sixth Fleet in June 1967? Well, he actually wasn't very famous, but his son was. His name was George Morrison. His son was Jim Morrison, who some people might have heard, the singer from The Doors. And he was in charge of the Sixth Fleet. Jim Morrison, quite famously, when he was asked again and again, you know, where's your father, what does your father do, he would say, my father's dead. Actually, it was really because he was slightly embarrassed that he was singing songs really about revolution and campaigning against the Vietnam War, when his father had actually been involved in the Gulf of Tonkin incident, which is one of the things that kicked off the Vietnam War. But anyway, an interesting guy to be in charge of the fleet when the Israelis attacked the USS Liberty. And bizarrely, what Admiral Morrison, Jim Morrison's father, then did was order an immediate strike on Israel. 1967 June, they took he had aircraft carriers and things, and they sent a load of phantom jets armed to the teeth to bomb the airfields where the jets that had attacked the Liberty had come from. And while they were actually on their way to attack Israel in this is obviously would have been a big international incident. The Americans are at war with Israel, you know. There came orders from the Pentagon, stop, pull the planes back. And who was it on the phone? It was a man called John McCain, the father of Senator John McCain, who stood to be president in the last, it was absolutely crazy, John McCain, actually the previous but one Republican guy. He was in the Navy at the Pentagon, and he said, no, pull those planes back. We want to negotiate with the Israelis. We're sure there's some terrible mistake. So there is the obvious implication here that possibly Jim Morrison, who died in 1971 in Paris, was killed because his father was a major influence, an anti-Israeli influence within the US military. And he was lobbying for tougher sanctions. I mean, for example, he lobbied for economic sanctions immediately the same day of the attack on the Liberty against Israel. The circumstances around Morrison's death, I mean, there's all sorts of Jim Morrison, that is quite disputed. In that we were told that he died of a heroin overdose in the bath, and died in the bath. Actually, the fact of the matter was he never ever took heroin. He had a fear of needles, didn't want anything to do with it, and he was a bit of a drinker. So why would he suddenly decide that one night to take heroin? The other thing was his father was called, it's on the video is on YouTube, of his father being interviewed, and his father was called by the US naval attaché in Paris when they found his son was dead. And he said, oh yeah, he died in hospital of a heart attack. Hang on a minute. He was never taken to hospital. So why would the naval attaché lie to his father about where he died and how he died? All very strange. Yet there's another thing which has come out more recently. It's one of his close friends who was in Paris with him said that Morrison had died in a nightclub and his body had been moved and dumped in the bath. So clearly something dodgy going on. But I was interested in, okay, so if Morrison died in suspicious circumstances, what might be the motive? And it was very interesting to come across this Daily Telegraph article about about the his father being involved on this attempt to bomb Israel during the Six-Day War after the Liberty. So there's a few stories anyway. I think I find it interesting getting into these things, and I'm always looking if something funny is going on, like if there's questions over a big event, like for example this recent Malaysian airliner, lots of questions. What might the motives be? Drill down and find those. I think also worth mentioning one book which I've read over the last couple of years, which has really changed my view of the post-war world. And it was, if you don't read anything else, it's available free online, or you can buy it, I think, on most of these sort of book sites. It's called Martin Bormann, Nazi in Exile. And it was written by a guy called Paul Manning. Paul Manning was CBS's news correspondent in Europe during World War II. Now, he was doing things like flying in American aircraft that were bombing Germany during the war. And he was doing those reports back to millions of people in the US. So he was one of the key people sort of telling the Americans what was going on in Europe. And afterwards, he became, some might say, obsessed with tracing what had happened to all the loot the Nazis had looted from Europe at the end of the war. And he traced a lot of it back to Argentina. But he also discovered that one of the key figures who had their hands on the Nazi bank accounts, Martin Bormann, who was Hitler's secretary, his death had been faked very crudely, not very well, but he'd spent about 20 years actually over in South America, living in South America, and he documents all of this. And what Bormann was up to when he was over in South America was setting up companies. He was a bureaucratic guy. He was setting up companies in European countries and in the United States and Canada and places like that. He set up 750 corporations, and the money was laundered, the loot from the war was laundered mostly through this New York law firm, Sullivan and Cromwell, which was connected with the Dulles brothers, who were another dodgy couple of, extremely dodgy. I mean, they were Nazis before the war, but then they became after the war. The Dulles brothers, one was Secretary of State in the US, and the other one was head of the CIA. They were doing all sorts of really dodgy stuff, and they'd been friendly with the Nazis before the war anyway. So Martin Bormann, Nazi in Exile, really explains how the Nazis got this loot and they got all these guys who'd been in the SS or been supporters of the SS during the war, and they just took off their uniforms, put on nice suits and made them directors of these companies. Now, quite where those companies are now, God only knows. But certainly there are some figures, for example, connected with the Bilderberg Conference, the families were involved, and you can read about them in his book, in the immediate post-war world, in helping launder all this loot. I mean, we don't hear the question, do we, very often, what did happen to all the loot from the war? Because everywhere the Nazis went, they brought everything back to Berlin. But where did it all go? When the Russians got to Berlin, it had gone. So, I mean, personally, I think quite a lot of it was Spain, quite a lot was Switzerland, but certainly a lot in Argentina. I mean, they had their own Nazi party going on in Argentina through the war anyhow. And I've been in touch with a journalist called Lawrence DeMello over there. She's British, and she's worked for Discovery Channel and things like that. But she entertains me. You know, she said, well, when I first arrived in Buenos Aires, it was like everyone's talking about the Nazis next door. It's all just normal over here. They're everywhere. But, of course, they don't wear the swastikas. They just have that attitude, and they wear suits and ties, and they're all very polite now. Moving on to the 1970s and 80s, after the Six-Day War and Jim Morrison and all that stuff, Operation Gladio, another really important thing that people just don't know about. Has anyone here heard about Operation Gladio? There's one here, there's one. Anyone else? This is NATO, guys, NATO. Yeah, NATO going around Europe, particularly Italy, because Italy was very left-wing, blowing up people, innocent people, machine-gunning people, and then blaming it on far-left groups that were supported by the Russians. So this idea the public gets to say, oh, no, isn't it dreadful? We've got the Red Brigades, we've got the Baader-Meinhofs, we've got Action Direct in Belgium, these terrible extreme left-wing groups. They're being funded by Moscow. And actually, it was NATO all the time. NATO's Operation Gladio is documented really well, although hardly ever. I mean, it's like taboo, man. We've got NATO coming down beginning of September, haven't we, to Newport, if anyone knows about this. There's going to be quite a big demonstration. I was just chatting the other day to some peace activists from Cardiff. You know, NATO are coming to Newport at the beginning of September for a couple of days to have their annual conference. And I think maybe we should buttonhole them and say, what were you doing in the 1970s and 80s, blowing people up all around Europe, and then trying to blame it on somebody else? The reason they did it, I mean, and people wonder, why would you blow up Bologna Railway Station in 1980 and kill nearly 100 people in a third-class waiting room? What would be the point of that? Why did you do it? Well, the answer was that it was to create this thing called a strategy of tension. So the idea being that the political classes in Italy would be really afraid of the left, and they would be driven into the hands of the securocrats, the security state and the government. And it worked really horrifyingly well. In Belgium, for example, the Belgian government were about to bring in cruise missiles, like we did here. Belgian government had a debate about it, and they decided, no, we're not having these cruise missiles. We think they're completely crazy, unnecessary, and they make Belgium a target for Russian nukes, so we're not having them. Now, within weeks, this new little organisation, Action Directed, the posters were put up. Actually, we now find out by soldiers around Belgian cities for this new organisation that didn't really actually exist, called Action Direct, with a big red star on it. And then attacks started happening in supermarkets. In Belgium, someone would be just going about doing your shopping. Suddenly, you'd hear machine guns going off in the supermarket. People were massacred. There was altogether about 80 people and several massacres going on in Belgium. That was all NATO, and what they were doing, and it was absolutely right and successful, was convincing the Belgian government that they really did need those cruise missiles, and they did decide we need those cruise missiles after the attacks on the Belgian supermarkets. So I start looking at connections between this Nazi attitude, callous attitude towards human life, etc., and genocide, and see a lot of this expressed in some of the NATO operations. This Operation Gladio, by the way, was filmed for the BBC. Well, you wouldn't see that today. But in the 1990s, Time Watch did a three-part series on Operation Gladio. And if anyone's watched it, it is one of the most riveting. I mean, you know, you might start find it boring, but I actually find this stuff riveting. Get the popcorn in. And it's going into some of the real detail of just how callous NATO was in killing people anywhere, so long as they could bounce the government and bounce through the media, bounce the public into supporting the US, because this was all being blamed on the far left. The director, by the way, is probably one of the greatest filmmakers ever. His name's Alan Frankovich, and he managed to get this past Lawrence Rees, who was the BBC Time Watch editor. And I think from that moment, I don't think there's been such a good documentary on TV which has been so self-critical, because that's what we need, isn't it? We want television to be critical of our governments, of our militaries. And nowadays, it's not. It's just sort of goes along with their line. I mean, even the broadcasting has been over Gaza the last few days. When I've been listening to it, I think, well, that's the Israeli line. You're just coming out at the top of the news with the Israeli line again and again. They talk about kidnapping, don't they? Have you ever heard anyone refer to someone who's captured in a battle as someone being kidnapped? I've never thought of it like that at all. If you're kidnapping, it's in a sort of peaceful situation and not in the middle of a war. You can't kidnap. Anyway, I don't personally think that anyone has been kidnapped personally, but anyway, that's just my slightly biased view about the Israelis' use of these kinds of memes in the press to get some kind of sympathy, because really they shouldn't have any sympathy for what they're doing. Okay, so Frankovich, he also did the Dispatches documentary in the 90s on Lockerbie, which is also well worth a look. Again, some of these programs, they just open your eyes as to what we're not getting today. The Lockerbie documentary is called The Maltese Double Cross. Makes it pretty clear that as soon as the Lockerbie jet came down, the Pan Am jet came down, the American intelligence services were all over the crash scene. Even when the Scottish police first arrived, they found CIA people, American Secret Service, tampering with the scene immediately. So Frankovich goes into a lot of the details as to why he believes it was something like a CIA, good CIA investigation into bad CIA, and they were bringing back evidence to the US of drug running by other people in the CIA in the Middle East. And that's why they were brought down, because they didn't want that evidence to go back to the US. So there's all sorts of questions about Lockerbie. Certainly wasn't Megrahi, was it? I mean, the guy who was sent back to Libya, But it's just a setup to set up the Libyans, just like Yvonne Fletcher, another very good documentary about her, proved that she couldn't have been shot from the Libyan embassy. So we are in this situation over the last couple of years with the attack on Libya, where we're being told, oh, yes, they did the Lockerbie thing, isn't it dreadful? Oh, yes, they killed Yvonne Fletcher. If you actually look into it, you'll find they didn't either. Neither were done by the Libyans. And this is what I mean about they want you to forget. They're going to, you know, those documentaries went out, but then we're supposed to completely forget that they ever happened. I know Yvonne Fletcher's mum still questions what really happened. She's not so stupid as maybe the rest of us that haven't actually managed to watch Murder in St. James, which was a two-part dispatches documentary, including senior people from the army, a British army, saying, no, she was shot from above and a different part of the square, if you look at the trajectory of the bullet through her body. Very, very clear. So it wasn't the Libyans that shot Yvonne Fletcher, so get that idea out of your head. Since then we've had 9/11. So this is a sort of pattern, isn't it? Isn't it a bit of a pattern that's going on here with Gladio, these other sort of false flag operations? 9/11, some very clear stuff about that. If you just look at Building 7, you don't need to do anything else, but then you can see quite clearly this Building 7 has been brought down by controlled demolition. No plane hit it. There's a few little fires in it, but the thing goes down at free fall speed. What happened to Building 7? And that starts to open up the can of worms, which is 9/11. My own theory is that the plane that was brought down at Shanksville, against orders, by the way, by a pilot that brought the plane down because he could see it was heading for New York, that plane was the one that was supposed to hit Building 7, but it was brought down by a conscientious pilot who was going against orders because he knew there was this crazy hijack thing going on. And he was told by Dick Cheney, don't take the plane down. But he did take the plane down, and that was the one that was supposed to go into Building 7. That's just my little theory. But there's a very good book on 9/11 called 9/11 Synthetic Terror, made in the USA. And it makes it clear that George Bush, the president, wasn't in on it at all. He was just being bullied to come up with the right statements at the right time. In fact, his life was threatened that day on 9/11 itself. Then the 7/7 bombings. Now, the 7/7 London bombings in 2005, I felt really personally, I mean, actually I was over in Hungary at a Global Eco Village Network get-together that day, and that's just as we were leaving, some people from the Eco Village we were staying at in Hungary said, hey, there's been a big attack in London. Anyway, when I got back, straight away got on online and started having a look. Now, the first thing I saw, and this is no lie, a story from the Associated Press, Benjamin Netanyahu changed his plans due to a warning. This is on the Associated Press. Hang on a minute, a warning? This was a surprise attack. Where did he get a warning from? So all sorts of dodgy stuff to do with 7/7 again. We sell a series of documentaries online about it. But if you've not ever looked into 7/7, there's a very good film which was made about 6 months afterwards called Ludicrous Diversion, which was Tony Blair's words. He said, to have a public inquiry into the attacks would be a ludicrous diversion. There's Blair for you. But of course, it's extremely, what actually eventually happened with 7/7 was a series of inquests, 52 inquests. You talk to any lawyer, anyone who's got any kind of involvement with the judiciary, they'll tell you, well, you don't do 52 inquests. You do a public inquiry. Whole point is that it stops people having to go through evidence again and again and again. You have a public inquiry which includes all the deaths of those 52 people. But they didn't even have a jury at the inquests either. So the whole thing again, and the relatives, I've spoken to some of the relatives, they're totally left hanging by this. There's no closure for them as to what really happened on 7/7. Again, there's evidence that there was a warning. If there was a warning, why weren't we told? I actually spoke to foreign affairs editor of the Scottish Sunday Herald the other week, and he told me more about 7/7. He said, oh yes, I was chatting to the Israeli embassy that morning and they told me that they'd gone extra level of security the day before. That's the 6th of July 2005. The security levels at the Israeli embassy had been upped the day before 7/7. So, you know, if they knew, as Netanyahu apparently knew, because he didn't actually leave his hotel that morning, he stayed in his hotel because his people had warned him, why didn't he tell anyone else? The whole thing is extremely strange, and there's a lot of questions. I mean, one of the simple ones is the police report was a load of rubbish that they did into it, called the narrative. that was brought out about 6 months afterwards. It turned out that the train that the four alleged bombers were supposed to take to London, that train didn't even run that day. So they didn't do a very good investigation, the police, did they? We've also since found out that the people involved in all that have been also committing crimes in other ways. I mean, for example, one of the people was sacked quite recently and put onto this inquiry in Birmingham into Trojan Horse from this team at the Met who was supposed to be looking into the London bombings. All sorts of dodgy stuff involved in with them. So I don't think we have much faith in the Met. I mean, luckily, you know, some police forces are better than the Met. Thank God they're not all quite so appalling. Okay, I don't know. I'd like be nice to have a bit of time for discussion, wouldn't it, as well, to talk about some more recent stuff. But I'll finish off with some three big stories this weekend. We talked about Gaza a bit, didn't we? A little bit. There's a lot of accusations about the Israelis being acting like Nazis, isn't there? I mean, I don't know if you hear this. I certainly do hear it. And I don't like the way that this genocide is just seen to be totally normal and acceptable. And it is, you know, a massive extermination of people. The only real choice that a Gazan person's got nowadays is to get out of the land, isn't it? And to move, to get away. I would just point you to back to, I'm trying to think of the year it was, 2011, wasn't it? Anders Breivik, this Norwegian Freemason, funnily enough. Did you ever see that? Breivik, the Norwegian crazy assassin guy, it went in and massacred. I mean, it'd be like someone coming in here with an automatic rifle and killing nearly 100 people. That's what he did at the Norwegian Labour Party summer camp back in 2011. But he was not only a Freemason, and there were pictures online at the time straight away of him with in his Masonic outfit, but there he was doing Nazi salutes, and he said he did it for Israel. Because one of the reasons that he went into that summer camp is because they were planning and plotting boycotts against Israel. There's a fantastic article by a guy called Torstein, who lives in Oslo, and who actually, his windows in his flat were broken by the bomb that went off before Breivik went over and did the massacre. Because he points out that in his manifesto, Breivik treats Zionism exactly as Nazism. And in fact, he does a Nazi salute. There's pictures of him doing a Nazi salute in court. And yet he's doing it for the Zionists. We also have seen, I don't know if other people have seen this, I've seen it with my own eyes, Zionists with Israeli flags turning up at EDL marches, for example. So there's all sorts of nasty connections with the far right and Zionism, which I suppose we wouldn't be madly surprised to see nowadays. But anyway, that's one story, which is the Gaza. That's just another side of Gaza, is this Zionism. And in a way, it's a heresy, isn't it? It's almost like bang back in medieval times. We believe that this is our land. That God's given it to us, and we can just do anything. But it's like, you know, you're some kind of mad crusader from hundreds of years ago. No, it's not your land. What about the right of return for the Palestinians, right? They're going to start going, well, that was our land a few years ago. We're going to have it back now and fight you. What you're doing is you're creating a diabolical situation for the future. And it really is Britain's responsibility, this. We created the state of Israel in the first place back in 1947. And of course, who was it who first recognized Israel? It was the Americans. Before anybody else in the world, the Israeli terrorists said, we're setting up a state here. The Americans said, great, straight away, fine. And the Americans started the whole movement really for it to become a legitimate state, Israel. A lot of people still don't accept it, and of course they don't sign up to many treaties, a lot of treaties they don't sign up to. So that's Gaza, the one thing, and that's, you know, it's almost like a minute silenceville for Gaza, but maybe we won't. The other one is this MH17, the Malaysian airliner. I mean, I wrote something for the Russians on this the day it happened, and Russia Today, and I was just like, well, you know, you lose one airliner, it might be a mistake, but you lose two airliners of Malaysian Airlines, it starts to look like negligence of some sort. I mean, this is nicking from importance of being earnest, but it is a bit weird, isn't it? The two Malaysian airliners are the two ones that go missing. Well, the Malaysians are not greatly liked by the West. The Malaysians have put Bush and Blair on trial 4 years in a row and found them guilty in public. And also, they won't do what they're told by the IMF either. They have decided to completely go against what the IMF wants them to do. And they're a very independent-minded Muslim nation. So if you're going to shoot, there's lots of airliners going over, you're going to shoot one down, and you happen to be part of this kind of evil NATO regime that seems to be around in the West at the moment, why not shoot down a Malaysian airliner? I don't personally think that there's anything in it for the Russians or the separatists. I don't even think that there's actually really no evidence that the separatists had one of these book missiles that's supposed to have. In fact, there is a photo that the press have put out of a book missile in a square in somewhere in eastern Ukraine. Now, the radio, I was listening on the radio in the car, someone from the radio spoke to the woman across the road in one of the shops, and she said, well, they're saying this was there yesterday. No, it wasn't there yesterday. I can only say that this has probably been photoshopped in, this missile, into the picture. So this is the kind of rubbish we're dealing with. The other thing is, the main evidence that the separatists were behind the plane coming down is the transcripts, apparently, and audio recordings of the separatists saying, oh, we've shot a plane down. Only one problem with that. If you look into it, you'll find that the original recording was uploaded the day before the Malaysian airliner was brought down. So maybe it was one of the other 10 planes that was shot down in the previous months they were talking about, and that's just been uploaded. And, you know, this is all rather cheap psyop, psychological warfare. And we are training, many people in this country are trained by the military and in the US and in other countries on psychological warfare. The military have got a psychological warfare unit in Bedfordshire, for example. And I've spoken to one of the guys who was trained there. He's not working there anymore because he was tapped on the shoulder and said and told, how would you like to earn 10 times more and come and work for us? So he's trained by the military, but he's now working for a private corporation in the world of strategic communications. Now, this is something we don't, you know, I'd like to see a documentary about strategic communications, because these guys say, oh, we'll fix an election for you, you know, don't worry about that. Just tell us what, you know, pay us or whatever, and it costs this much and you'll win the election. And if you're stupid enough as some small prime minister or president to say, oh, no, I think my people love me, yes, well, you'll probably find that the strategic communications people will go to your opposition and they'll say, well, actually, we've got this nice deal, we'll put in a dam, we'll build some factories, we'll do this, we'll do that, and we'll also do psychological warfare in your country, and you'll get in. So the company's called SCL. Has anyone ever heard of SCL? Strategic Communication Labs. This is like public relations on steroids. And these guys are where the military go when they want to get a bit more money. I mean, for example, in Libya, I don't know how many people know, but there was a tax on all the Libyans' internal radio stations. I spoke to someone who supplied the Navy with those transmitters to block the Libyans' radio. This is all psychological warfare. They boast that they can make people give up without a single shot being fired. And there's a lot of money goes into psychological warfare, which is why the media is such a key thing and why it's in such, an appalling state in the Western world these days. Okay, so that's the Malaysian airliner. What about another big story this weekend? The Senate Intelligence Committee has been spied on. They were looking into torture. People have heard this story the last couple of days. The Senate Intelligence Committee were looking into torture by the CIA, but the CIA were spying on them all the time. And John Brennan, who's the director of the CIA, went to the committee and in front of the committee said, no, we're definitely not spying on you. But they found out yesterday that he was spying on them. But he's still in his job. Now, the CIA, what can I say about the CIA? One of the most despicable organizations. And Alan Frankovich, I was talking about earlier on, made some fantastic films in the 1980s, etc., about the CIA and their interventions in South America and elsewhere. But the fact of the matter is, there was one journalist who was really getting up the nose of the CIA last year. His name was Michael Hastings. Michael Hastings worked for, Rolling Stone magazine. And he also wrote a book as well about it all. And he was embedded with the US commanders in Afghanistan, etc. He went around the world. Wonderful writer, brilliant writer. Please buy and read his stuff, Michael Hastings. Because at the end of last summer, he went around to see his girlfriend in Los Angeles, and his girlfriend, he asked her if he could borrow her car because he said, my car's acting weird. I don't like it. It's something wrong with the steering. and can I borrow your car? But she said, no, you can't. I'm sorry, because my car's going in tomorrow itself to be fixed, so you can't borrow the car. Anyway, that was a real tragedy, because as he was driving away from his girlfriend's place, his car accelerated up to 80 miles an hour. He was in a black Mercedes and steered into a tree and exploded, and he's dead. Now, there is this quite, I mean, we've had an announcement this week, haven't we, about driverless cars. What is going on with technology? I don't get it. It's quite feasible and easy, we're told, by the DARPA in the States to hack into cars' computers. So if you've got a car that, like I know some people who've got a car, and it parks itself. You press a button and it just parks itself. The steering moves and everything. It's got a computer that does it for you. Isn't that wonderful? Well, what if it starts doing that when you're doing 80 miles an hour on the motorway? Yeah? These cars can be hacked. Of course they can be hacked quite easily. There's various ways. One is even with a, because they're connected up via radio in some way, so it can even be hacked remotely like that. But if you put a CD into the car system, that CD can play like a normal CD, but it can have a virus on it that goes onto your car computer. The other thing is, when you plug the car into the diagnostics down at Mercedes, I don't want to, you know, slur Mercedes or anything, but Mercedes, dangerous damn cars. Like Diana was in a Mercedes, wasn't she? And Audi do it, and Toyota do it as well, right? But, you know, I would say don't have a car that does this kind of thing. So you go into the diagnostic port at the garage, and in goes the virus. That DARPA have got a really interesting video where they say, and they you can see online where people are sitting in the back of a car with a smartphone, messing with your steering on their smartphone. So this is a dangerous technology, really crazy dangerous technology, and I think Michael Hastings was murdered by that technology, by the CIA. He was investigating John Brennan, funnily enough, same John Brennan we've been hearing about this week, and John Brennan, he was investigating him for spying on politicians and journalists. Now this is Watergate-style stuff, because you've got the spy agencies are so out of control, so completely, nobody's actually keeping an eye on them properly, they're in another world, they're like a cult or something, completely cut off from the public, and some of them are literally killing people, killing Michael Hastings. I mean, this book is still around. It's really well worth reading. And I just think it's appalling we're in a situation where someone who's actually there to tell us the truth, investigating, doing, putting themselves on the line, can just be murdered like that with hardly a murmur. And Mercedes have said nothing about it whatsoever. Everyone that's tried to get answers from Mercedes about, is your car hackable, have got no reply at all. Anyway, I do... I do a radio program in Bristol on Fridays, which where we have it's all live from 5 till 7, which you can pick up on the internet if you like, or it's all archived. Well, we have a politician in the first hour. Last night it was the leader of the Lib Dems at Bristol City Council, who's quite a feisty character, having a go at the mayor, and also us having a go at him about the Lib Dems and various things. But then also in the second half we do more investigative stuff. So we float the boat out, and the thing is, if you're going to have freedom of speech, you've got to use it. Yeah, the only way you can maintain freedom of speech is to push and keep using that freedom of speech. Otherwise, it all becomes a bit of a mush, and we become like victims of psychological warfare. I mean, the big media corporations, I think, are pretty much in the grip of the military-industrial complex. Through all sorts of reasons, journalists who have got a big audience, not me, but journalists who have got a big audience, are sort of gently weeded out. Look at what's happened to Newsnight, for example, over the last year or so. We started with Michael Crick, very good political journalist. He was bullied out because he was doing all these interviews with politicians, and then he'd come back and find somebody at Newsnight office has deleted my interview. And he's then told, oh, we haven't got enough space on the hard drive. And he's saying, no, keep my interviews. I might want to use them in 6 months' time or whatever. Oh, no, there's not enough space on the hard drive. So eventually, after begging that his interviews he's doing with politicians can be kept for him to use in the future, he gave up and he went to Channel 4 News. Who else has left Newsnight? Jeremy Paxman's finally given up, hasn't he? I mean, you know, come out as a Tory and everything, but which you kind of knew anyway. But you know, at least he was dogged in his questioning. The other person, most important maybe, that's left is Paul Mason has been bullied out of Newsnight. Now, this is the programme that refused to broadcast the interviews with Jimmy Savile, isn't it? Do you remember a couple of years ago? Liz McKean, who's their social affairs correspondent, interviewed some people who'd been, women who'd been abused by Savile. Now, it's very difficult to get someone to go on camera to talk about an experience which was so horrific all those years ago. They want to forget about it. But she'd managed to do it. Liz had done it. And by the way, I worked with Liz back in the 1990s in Greater London Radio. Fantastic woman. But she'd got these interviews in the bag. And Peter Rippon, who was the Newsnight editor, said, no, you're not going to broadcast those. We're not going to broadcast those because we've got the Jimmy Savile special coming up at Christmas and it's all a bit embarrassing, so no. Now, what he's doing is he's actually putting his arm around Jimmy Savile by saying that, isn't he? He's saying, sod these people who've been abused by him, who've just put their lives on the, well, not their quite their lives, but almost everything on the line to go on camera on national television to talk about being abused. And those interviews are now going to go in the dustbin. So what an appalling way to behave at the BBC. And you know what happened to Peter Rippon? He's taken off Newsnight, but he's given a job in charge of the BBC archives. At the same pay. The same pay. No punishment at all. So one wonders what he's actually doing. What is he going through the archives to rip out of the archives and destroy? And I'll just finish by saying the other thing is the Cook Report. Hands up who ever saw the Cook Report in the 90s. Yeah, because it finished in 2000. That was one of the most wonderful programs ever. Really a wonderful TV show. And Roger Cook, bless him, he's still around. You know, he's got a bit of a bad hip and everything. But amazing guy. And he was pulling in audiences of 10 million people. What TV channel would turn its nose up at that? Well, the fact of the matter was he was bullied off by loads of lies printed in the News of the World, right? Over 4 weeks, loads of lies. And Central Television said, oh, I think we better pull the programme for a little while. And then he never got the programme back. But all the archives of the Cook Report were given to by David Cameron, because he was working for Carlton TV at the time in the 2000s or whatever, about 2001 or something. Cameron oversaw the archives of the Cook Report and put them in a place called Iron Mountain, right, to look after them. And then, funnily enough, almost immediately, there was a big fire in Iron Mountain. And all of the... all of the recordings of the Cook Report for all those years were all burnt to a cinder. So if anyone here has got an old recording of the Cook Report on an old VHS tape, see me afterwards. Anyway, thanks very much for listening, and we'll have a bit of question and answer. I hope we've got time for that. Well, I'll tell you what, if anyone wants to ask anything, have a chat afterwards. I'll just go outside or something. Yeah? Thanks. Sorry for overrunning. I didn't get any kind of sign that we were coming up to.
I was creeping towards you. It's mainly about 1 or 2 minutes. So now we've got Louise Somerville-Williams. In a minute or two, we'll be talking about Frack Free Somerset.
Oh, and if you've got any stories as well.